Everyone deserves to be loved,
heard,
affirmed,
and respected.
We at Oak Lawn UMC
believe that as a church, it is possible to offer this to one another when we listen,
learn,
appreciate diversity,
and love God above all else,
and our neighbors as ourselves.
Therefore, as individual parts of the church,
we pledge to move towards this corporate reality
so that the church can be a voice for the voiceless,
a home for the wanderer,
a respite for the weary,
a balm for the hurting, God's presence in the world.
Good morning, Oak Lawn. You all look beautiful, as always. I'm Taylor, I'm the lay leader here at Oak Lawn, and as always, I have some announcements. You can find them in your bulletin, on the digital bulletin, or if you're online, you can find it in that first comment. If you're new, we would love for you to fill out a Connect card. You can get them from Kathy at the front as you come in, or you can also find those online. Today, after church, we'd really love for y'all to stay for a very special cafe au later. The artist, Dimitri Cotton, who has all this beautiful artwork that's over here, will be here talking about his artwork, explaining a little bit more about his thought process behind it and how he, his practice, his art practice. So join us for that. Book club starts Monday night. This is the book. It is very small and it is mostly pictures and white space, so you can read it. But the good news is you don't need to read it for this week. Join us, it's just discussion. You still have time to get your book. So be there, we're gonna have a good time, and you could literally read this in 20 minutes. So we'll see you there. With that, let's prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Will you rise as you're able and join us in the call to worship? Christ is risen. Alleluia. We will rise up with the risen Christ out of the graves of stagnation and despair, out of the graves of cynicism and fear, out of the graves of othering and distrust. Christ is risen. Alleluia. We will go to the world with the risen Christ. With Christ, we will bear generosity and light. With Christ, we will proclaim wisdom and hope. With Christ, we will create poetry and wonder. With Christ, we will offer love and new life. Alleluia, we will go with Christ. Join us in our opening hymn, A Charge to Keep We Have. It's in the blue hymnal, number 413, or the words will be on the screen.
Thank you.
how's school this week? Good. Well, yes, state testing, right? The STAR test. Did y'all take one? You did? You didn't? Okay. Oh, okay. I teach seventh graders, and so we have our test on Thursday. So we have three more days of schooling, and then we're ready. So, you know, we've got it, okay? So today, this week, we're talking about 1 Peter, chapter 2, verse 19 through 25. And so there's a picture that is going to pop up on the screen. Do you know who this is? Yeah, okay. Did you know that Martin Luther King Jr. actually had a PhD? So he was Dr. Martin Luther King? Do you know what that PhD was in? He was a civil rights activist, right? So his PhD was in religion, okay? Yes, he did, okay? So when we look at Martin Luther King, he was a person who worked really hard to bring peace and kindness into the world. And so there were people who were very angry with him for doing these things. And so he tried to create change in people's lives, and he knew that we should treat people as they were beloved children of God. That was extremely important for him. And so he wanted to show that to the world. And like y'all mentioned, he had that I Have a Dream speech, and he gave that in Washington, D.C., right? He gave that to the people of the United States. And so no one is less of a person than anyone else because they are a boy or a girl or a person of God, or because of their skin, or the hair is straight or curly, right? We're all a person of God. And that's what Martin Luther King wanted to explain and tell everyone. And so the sad part of Martin Luther King's story is that he was treated pretty bad. And we probably know that part too, right? Just like the earth, yeah, exactly, right? So he was arrested, and he was beaten, and he was yelled at. And then eventually we know that he was killed, right, for his activism. And so in this verse that we're going to talk about today in church, Martin Luther King was... I thought of Martin Luther King when we were reading this because it was pretty scary that we should keep doing, or we know that we should keep doing what we're supposed to do, though, right? Just because it's scary, right? God calls us to do what's right. Does that make sense? Right? And so even if we get in trouble for doing it, we should probably still do what is right. If we're supposed to love people, we just need to keep loving them, right? Even if people tell us, oh, hey, we don't need to love them, we still gotta love them, right? But when we, sometimes acting with love can be the hardest thing to do. So acting with love might mean getting on the bad side of a bully because you help someone who's being bullied, or you tell a teacher or an adult about the bully. So acting with love means giving food or helping someone who is houseless, even if the other people want to ignore them. Yeah, don't we do that here? Yeah, that's a part of us acting out of that love, right? Yes, exactly. So that's the point of today. And so like just like Martin Luther King was trying to express God's love to all people and for all people, that's what we should be doing, right? We should be showing God's love and doing all that we can to show and tell and express the love of God, right? For everyone, okay? So why don't we pray real quick before we go about our day? Dear Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for bringing us here and bringing us together as a community and as a chosen family. We thank you for providing us with this opportunity to continue to invest our time into you, into this congregation, into these children. Lord, we thank you for the amount of love that you give us and the amount of love that you allow us to give to others. And we pray for this week as they go about their day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you so much. And as we all express our love for one another and sweet puppies,
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
How's everybody today? I'm John Horaney, and I've been a member of this church since 2007. When I moved to Oak Lawn, it was a really challenging time for me, and I was in a really, really dark space. And I was what you call one of those poinsettia and Easter lily Christians. I showed up at Christmas, I showed up at Easter, and then I went home. And even though God blessed me with a wonderful home life, in which regular attendance on Sunday morning worship was a part of my routine, somehow in the busyness of life and coming to college and graduating, it just didn't seem that important. Well, one day, a friend of mine saw me at JR's, surprise. By now it's about 2013. He says, well, I hear you're moving. I said, well, I'm not moving. He said, well, they said at church you're moving. Well, I said, well, that's wrong. So eventually I put it together. So what happens in our church? If you join, we make a pledge to support our church with our presence, our gifts, our time, and our service, and our witness. And you know what? I failed. And I realized I wasn't faithful in my witness. I wasn't faithful in my attendance. I wasn't faithful in my giving. And the church was saying, hey, this is the pledge you made. Well, I'd like to tell you that that next Sunday I was in church, but I wasn't. Okay, it took a while. And same friend came to me and said, hey, we're doing this cantata for Christmas. Would you come sing? And I love to sing. And I praise God all the time for the voice that God has given me to sing God's praises. So today I was looking up about generosity and identified like seven different kinds of generosity. Like most often we think about it in terms of cash, money, being generous with our financial resources. But we can also be generous in our thoughts, in our words, in our time, our things, our influence, and our attention. And because God created us, and because all of our gifts, all of our blessings were given to us, we didn't earn them. We're not good enough to get them. God bestowed those on all of us. I am a reader of the Upper Room meditation, daily meditation. And today's meditation seemed really appropriate for the message that God is calling for all of us. Today's meditation was based on Matthew 5, 43 to 48. Love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. Why is that significant? Because the scripture tells us it's easy to love the people that love you back. It's easy to take care of the people who are good to you. The challenge is to take care of the people that hate you, that revile you. And that's what God's call to generosity puts on all of us. And even today, we love our neighbors, even our challenging neighbors, even our neighbors like Francisco or Peso, who takes a gun and goes next door and shoots and kills people. We are called to pray for this man. We are called to pray for his victims, Sonia Argentina Guzman, Diana Velasquez Alvarado, Julissa Molina Rivera, Jose Jonathan Cesares, and Daniel Enrique Lasso, an 8-year-old angel that God has called home. We pray for them, and we pray pray for the alleged shooter. Because that's what God calls us to do. It's hard. Oh, it's so hard. But I ask you right now to join me in prayer. Oh God, our Creator, we give you thanks for this place of worship, for this place of community that you have sustained and supported for so long, oh Lord. We ask that you bless our hearts and call us to do the work that we're called to do each day, to be generous with the blessings that you've bestowed upon us, to share our love, our thoughts, our attention, our gifts, our things, our influence with others in this world which so desperately needs to know your love. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood. Yeah.
seated. Just want to take a moment again and give thanks for the gift that Joey and Leela give us when they sing. We love you guys. Good morning. The scripture for today that Pastor Rachel will preach from is from 1 Peter, the second chapter, verses 19 through 25. Listen for the word of God. Now, it is commendable if because of one's understanding of God, someone should endure pain through suffering unjustly. But what praise comes from enduring patiently when you have sinned and are beaten for it? But if you endure steadfastly when you've done good and suffer for it, this is commendable before God. You were called to this kind of endurance because Christ suffered on your behalf. He left you an example so that you might follow in his footsteps. He committed no sin, nor did he ever speak in ways meant to deceive. When he was insulted, he did not reply with insults. When he suffered, he did not threaten revenge. Instead, he entrusted himself to the one who judges justly. He carried in his own body on the cross the sins we committed. He did this so that we might live in righteousness, having nothing to do with sin. By his wounds, you were healed. Though you were like straying sheep, you have now returned to the shepherd and guardian of your lives. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Divine presence, you draw us near to the suffering. You uphold the weary and comfort the isolated. You bring strength to those who live righteously. May we too be companions to those who are persecuted for doing good. Make us friends of justice and unwavering in faithfulness to love, wherever and however it calls to us. Amen. This is not my favorite scripture. I've said that before. I really do like the Bible. And I really do read it. This particular scripture I believe to be one of the most dangerous and potentially most abused or misused scriptures in the whole of biblical literature for two reasons. One is that it calls us to endure mistreatment. And two, because of the context as it is positioned to enslaved people. Of course, when we come to scriptures like this, we have to explore the full context. We have to do our homework and do our best to understand why and when this was being written before we can begin to grasp what it has to say to us. In 380 AD, just over 300 years after 1 Peter was likely to be written, the small band of Jesus' followers, those earliest Christians, once persecuted by the state and socially ostracized, had officially become the religion of the Roman Empire. And while Christianity has certainly taken on many forms in many different communities and globally reflects a diverse set of experiences in terms of religious minorities and dominant groups, in the context of the United States and certainly elsewhere, Christianity remains the dominant religion, the religion largely practiced and enforced by the state.
in the scheme of history, it's astounding to remember how quickly this can change. And so it's important to step back and look at this from a bigger picture. And to be reminded that the choices we make in the name of getting through can lead to shaping a future that we never wanted or imagined. There is a powerful lure in the approval of what is normal, in the power of what is the dominant culture. The lure can be as human and as simple as our desire for belonging. It can be as material as being deprived of basic needs like resources of food and safety, security, housing. It can be as compromised as the want for power over others. Whatever our motivations, though, we all find ourselves enticed, I believe, at different times and ways toward shaping our behaviors and our beliefs and our practices based more on what we believe will appeal to those in power than what will be best for our people and our communities. This is a struggle for parts of every movement. Carving a path towards flourishing that doesn't simply take on unwanted aspects of the dominant group in order to win others over. Examples could be queers in churches, immigrants in America, women in patriarchal workplaces. There are countless examples of modern day communities who are forced to walk the oppressive tightropes of being true to self and true to one's collective community, while also carving out space to exist in a world that has not welcomed you or your people. This is a difficult and complicated reality, and no singular approach will do. There is no pure path, at least not one that I'm aware of, to pursue under dominant forces. We can and must, however, be incredibly mindful about what concessions we do make for ourselves and even more for others. Too often, history has shown that the compromises of movements and communities fall upon the shoulders of the most marginalized. The author of 1 Peter, clearly in conversation with a community wherein some were pushing back against upholding household codes. You might recall us talking about those during our Reclamation series. That chooses to advance the Christian community by tempering the radical values among them. He suggests that the enslaved should not challenge their place in society, and later in the letter, neither should women. And we know still today how often the needs and desires and equality of people living in poverty, people living under state control, are compromised for the advancement of others. So in this text, Peter writes to give us instructions, not out of their mistreatment, but through it. In other words, this is not primarily about relational reconciliation, but about relational endurance. He doesn't tell us how to heal the relationships. He tells us how to wade through the waters and endure. Peter is specifically addressing those who are enslaved. This text could easily be seen as a defense of slavery in general and American slavery in particular. In fact, this very text was used by whites in pre-Civil War America to argue that Scripture sanctioned and even provided guidelines for slavery. And it's no coincidence that it was used, because the instructions in this passage do not instruct the masters, but rather they seem to bring the slaves into greater subservience. The damage to the church's witness through the abuse of texts like this are innumerable. For hundreds of years, white Christians simultaneously preached the gospel of God's love for all God's image bearers, while also looking at black slaves and telling them that they are less than human and that they should simply submit, and tried to convince everyone that this is God's will. And if the current climate of racial justice, the climate of racial justice that you have known in your lifetime, has revealed anything, it's that hurt and pain caused by selfish twisting of the scriptures has not gone away. This is not a problem of our ancestors. This is our problem today. And it is a problem of misusing and abusing and twisting scripture for our own cultural, normative, dominant purposes. Let the history of this passage be a warning to us all. We have an unfathomable ability to sinfully twist our understanding of the scriptures and of ourselves to justify and protect our sin. That is so dangerous. And in particular, to my white siblings today, let me make this plea. Seize this opportunity to examine your own hearts and see any blindness to the sins of racism that reside in our hearts. Right now, today, this opportunity, we have nothing to lose except the sin that we are blind to. And I would love to lose that. And everything to lose by presuming our own innocence, much like our predecessors have done. In this text, Peter knows that some of his readers are slaves. And he wants to encourage them that even in their state as slaves, they have the choice to live as Christians. There is value in this. First Peter's approach, along with that of Colossians and Ephesians, are an attempt to hamper the spirits of resistance among women and enslaved people and others looking for a community to practice life differently. Patriarchally appropriate behavior was encouraged to persuade authorities that Christian communities were not a threat to the state. This was a much bigger political picture. But here's the thing. The practices that 1 Peter urged, silencing the ones in the community who were calling for Christians to do away with household codes in order to carve a path towards security for the larger community, cannot be disentangled from the future Christianity that would take shape because of this. A future that reflected the very dominant values that Jesus challenged and was executed for resisting. Bless you, Lucas. When we are doing the creative work of building new kinds of communities, when we are practicing countercultural beliefs, living a faith that resists evil among us and around us, we will inevitably face resistance. We are well acquainted with this reality. And when that resistance comes, what we do with our suffering, what choices we make in response, can and will shape our future together. So I think this text calls us to consider a few questions, and I'm not going to answer these questions for us, because these are our questions individually and as a community. What can we learn from the past mistakes of our Christian ancestors? What alternatives can we imagine that might have led to something other than becoming the empire itself? How can we commit to a more creative practices of endurance, of resistance, and bridge building that center the marginalized voices rather than compromising them? How does our faith and the power of love that we are about here, mutual solidarity and justice, how can these things shape our choices as we learn to live together? I want to encourage you to let these questions sit with you. Not to receive this scripture as necessarily instructive for us today, but maybe as a story that teaches us a value, a lesson, as we consider the complications and implications of it on our lives. And then as we work to build new communities that look different from the cultural dominant norms, we will have to make difficult choices together. There will be suffering. There will be necessary compromises. But with the Holy Spirit and the spirit of a creative creator, we can break patterns of old. We can move from the margins first. We can leave the practices of dominance behind and choose a new path. We can build communities that don't lead us into the same old dominant forces under a new name just a few hundred years later. But to do that, we have to start practicing now. And we have to do it together. It can't be one of us on our own. We do this work together as a loving and faithful community. It doesn't mean it's going to be easy. That doesn't mean there will not be suffering. But it means that we are committed to not becoming the empire we resist. Amen. As we come to this table today, we do so as a community, as a chosen and loving family. And this table is not the table of Oak Lawn United Methodist Church. This is a table of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And all are welcome at this table. There is a seat for you. There is a seat here for someone in your life that you haven't invited to church yet. Are they sitting in JR's right now? Please let them know when you go there at noon that there's a seat at this table for them too. And all are welcome.
The Lord.
and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through the prophets. You brought us to a land flowing with milk and honey and set before us the way of life. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. By your great mercy, we have been born anew into a living hope through the resurrection of your Son from the dead and to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading. Once we were no people, but now we are your people, declaring your wonderful deeds in Christ, who called us out of darkness and into his marvelous light. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And likewise, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, and he shared it with his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you, for this is the blood of a new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you eat this bread and drink from this cup, do this in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. come today and to receive this gift of God's love and grace in your life. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ, broken for you. And the cup of the new covenant, poured out for you. Amen. You're invited to come and to receive. You're invited to stay and kneel and offer prayer if you'd like. And if this is just not something you're ready for, you're welcome to sit and pray and just think about what the gifts are in your life of God's love.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Please rise as you are able for our closing hymn, which is in The Faith We Sing 2072. Our amazing music director, Cody, the fabulous Cody himself, is going to lead us in this hymn that we may not be familiar with. Yes.
Check one. All right, so what's gonna happen? I'm gonna teach you the amens of this, and then I will be singing the verses on top of that. So we'll have a little call and response teaching moment. So here's how the first amen goes. Amen. Your turn. Amen. Here's the second one. Amen. Your turn. Amen. Here's the third one. It's long. Amen. Amen. Your turn. Amen. Amen. Put them all together and
it's a win. All right, receive this benediction that I give, and then you can hear Lucas is out there. With humility, we learn from the past. With compassion, we shape our present. And with holy boldness, we imagine our future. Friends, God has given us the power and the creativity to leave that which deadens us behind as we build new patterns for living together. And so let us go with hope. Let us go transforming our lives to transform the world, trusting in the God who brings life from places of death. Go in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.